So today we're looking at Galak-Z. Galak-Z. Haha.
The Galak-Z.
Yeah. Oh. I don't say Z.
Yeah, I'm sure some of our UK folks refer to this game as Galak-Z.
Galak-Z.
The dimensional.
A lot of people I know do say the Galak-Z, but that gets rid of the pun. So we're doing like a play and review.
Yeah.
Ish. I'm here with Jamaal. And
yeah, what's up?
Yeah, I guess let's just do it.
Yeah, so this is Galak-Z, the dimensional made by 17-bit. This game's been in development for quite some time. I played it at PAX East last year. That was like the first trade show that I've been to, by the way. And I didn't really quite understand what the game was. I messed around with it. The controls are weird. I didn't know what the hell I was doing. I died very quickly and I was like, all right, well, fuck this game. I'm just going to move on to other games here. You know, it's been getting a decent amount of praise. I kind of just picked it up on the PlayStation Store like promotion, summer promotion thing that's going on for this month. And I was like, you know what? Fine. I'll just, pick up this game, try to review it. And I like it a lot with some caveats. So it is a roguelike or roguelite, which I guess that kind of, talks about how like there is some there's some element of progression that goes on, that goes through specific playthroughs.
You've reviewed a couple of those kind of games, though.
Yeah. I think Harry did Rogue Legacy. I did Tower of Guns, and I know Amber's probably done like a handful of those. Yeah, there are a lot of these little games. It's roguelikes are kind of the new hotness these days. Cool. After games like Binding of Isaac and Spelunky, so on and so forth. So
right, well, let's take a look at it. Let's see how it. See how it plays.
Yeah. So the interesting thing, we didn't get a chance to take a look at like the intro, but this has like a very flavorful like 80s anime style.
Okay.
Even you could see like down in the 17-bit corner, it has like like this Japanese text.
Yeah.
And the aesthetic is that it is broken up into seasons.
Okay. Cool.
Like similar to a TV show, and even the seasons themselves are have like this episodic format. I mean, if you even look back to games like Alan Wake, like each chapter in that game, sort of closes with like this credit screen. This very much does the same thing in this game.
Okay.
Even at the beginning of every episode has like such and such episode written by so and so. So
cool. All right.
It really kind of dives in into that aspect. So there are four available right now. The fifth one I think will be released I think sometime next month or October.
Okay.
The developer said. So it'll be a bit of an add-on DLC.
Cool.
So I'm going to jump right into season two.
Season
I'm going to skip the intro.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's just see.
Yeah, we're just going to dive right in.
Cool.
So I'm going to be, explaining like a ton of systems because this game is incredibly, incredibly complex.
Okay.
I'm working on the review right now, which hopefully should be up either sometime this week or by the end of this week.
Oh, you fly.
And I'm trying to, yeah.
How are those tight pants?
Yeah. What's that?
How are those tight pants feeling?
Oof, yeah. I mean, look at that. Look at that cod piece or lack thereof. I mean, it is just right up there. Yeah, but he's pretending to be comfortable.
Acts like it's cool, even though we know it's not.
So this is Beam, your main character who is just sitting there with the uncomfortable cod piece is ATAC. He is like the last pilot of like I think like the Federation or something like that. So each mission, at least the four first missions of each season, or episodes of each season, is kind of broken up to like these randomized missions. But the last chapter, which we won't get into today, I'll just kind of talk about it briefly, is an actual story mission. So the story's kind of weird.
So it's kind of like, that reminds me of like X-Files, where it's like, hey, first and last episode of each season are part of the long-running story, and then everything else is skippable.
Yeah. I mean that's an interesting way of looking at it. I mean it's kind of distracting, to be perfectly honest.
Okay.
I like the way that this sets it up because You know, the whole element of roguelike type games is that the there's a lot of randomization and procedural generation in its design, both in how the levels are structured and both how the missions are delivered. So in this game, the missions are sort of like randomly generated. So here I'll retrieve a data cube, another mission I'll kill some bugs, another mission I'll collect some crystals, and they just sort. They're assorted like that, you know, okay. Just that random. But the last mission is always like an actual story mission. You know, whether you're rescuing somebody right. or you're infiltrating something or what have you.
Okay.
So I'm going to move on. So this is the store, and this is very, very important. Actually, let's see here. So how about this? I want you to take note, and I'm going to take note as well, of the upgrades that are available in the store right now. Okay, so right now, just to kind of review what's on the top of the screen, you have your health, shields, missiles, and you have crash coins. Now, crash coins are accumulated. You know, you get an average about 10 per season. And what those do is if you get 5 of them, and or at least 5, and you die... you are given the opportunity to jump back into the mission. So
right from where you died.
To how this game is a roguelike. Each season has to be played without dying. You die, okay. Everything gets wiped. With the exception of the crash coins, if you have at least 5, you can actually jump back to the mission that you were in, but it has a Dark Souls caveat to it where you have to retrieve your upgrades.
Oh, lame.
Yeah. But it's even more of a pain in the ass in this game than in Dark Souls, because in Dark Souls, it's where you died, right? So you can, you know, backtrack, and you know, Dark Souls is not a procedurally generated game. Like the design is locked. It's very specific. Right. But in this game, it's, you know, procedurally generated. I'm not sure if the level itself sort of, you know, generates itself again when you jump back in, but you won't know exactly where your stash is. So you would have to look around. And this game is hard. It is a hard-ass game. So there is a chance where you can go back, try to look for your shit, die, and then you lose everything.
Right, because then you don't have any more crash coins. Yeah.
So I'm just like, you know what? It's better that you, for me personally, I prefer to save the crash coins, because what happens is at the beginning of every season, your crash coins get turned into salvage, which is the green icon at the top right-hand corner. And for every crash coin, you get like 250 salvage, which is valuable. I mean, you are going to need to buy items and upgrades and health and stuff like that. Like, you know, health... damage is permanent. Shields do regenerate, but damage is permanent. Missiles are super useful, but they're finite. So you're going to need money to buy stuff, and upgrades are very, very useful. So having said all that, you know, we have nothing right now, so we're just going to dive right in. But let's say for the sake of right now, I may want to get double lasers, which do double damage, or auto fire, which increases the fire rate and it does more damage. So at this screen right here, you are able to swap out some of these bullet patterns and bullet shapes to augment your ship's abilities. So
cool.
We're going to dive right in. So
I like this art style.
Yeah, yeah. The art style is neat. It's very colorful.
This is the first thing I've seen of it so far.
Yeah, it looks pretty cool. It's very, very colorful. The animations and the cutscenes, or some of the cutscenes, aren't that great. If it uses like 3D models and stuff like that looks okay. But when it goes like the 2D models, like the characters that you saw at the mothership, then they look kind of like flashlight.
Right.
Okay. So the controls are very similar to Asteroids. It's very momentum based. You can do all sorts of stuff. You could, you know, regular boost, an actual, like a powerful boost that there's a sort of an energy bar that's filling up.
Right, I see that.
You can do stuff like you can fly backwards and shoot, as you're running away from enemies, or say if this asteroid right here is an enemy, and I'm trying to, you could also circle strafe, and you can boost the circle strafe. Say if he's firing at me and I want to get away from his line of fire, I can boost around it.
I like how your little guy in the corner like emulates what's going on in the ship too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And when you're
not perfectly,
damage,
but
when you're in critical damage, he does, you know, start freaking out. All right, so those arrows are the enemies.
Okay.
And they're different colors because they're different factions in this game.
Okay.
So you can actually...
it's like Bloods and Crips.
Let me see if I can try it. Eh, you know what? There's a wall here. Okay, so let me see if I can mess around with this. So this guy's... I've got this guy's attention. And I'm going to try to... Yeah, there you go, and now he's attacking him. Bugs are incredibly weak. They're not of much use. They're more useful for distracting. So now these guys are coming after me. I can juke, which you can see my ship do like a little hop.
Yeah. Do a barrel roll.
Yeah, exactly. It is a barrel roll. Let's see. So we do have two factions. The problem that I have with that strategy, because I was just actually looking at a video that the developer was doing with another outlet, is that... once I get their attention, like, they almost don't care about each other. They just go after me even though they hate each other.
Okay.
So it is kind of hard to do that. So let's see if I can mess with this guy. So here's some missiles. I'm locking onto him.
Nice.
Alright. I managed to mess him up. So... Alright, so let's see if
this game looks like it would drive me absolutely insane.
Huh?
This looks like it would drive me crazy. Like,
yeah. I mean, like, this in and of itself is kind of chaotic, right?
Yeah. Oh, freak, yeah.
Let me just highlight these guys. Now, I maybe...
What are you collecting there?
Okay, so that's salvage. So as you see in the right-hand corner,
oh, right,
I have 59 salvage. I got one crash coin, so that's good.
Okay.
So yeah, and, you know, little things like the asteroids are, you know, are destructible. All right, so how much of this game have you seen?
This much.
Just this much? Okay.
And so, a little bit, but this is pretty much it.
Yeah. So, I mean, this game, you know, pretty much looks like a very standard, space shooter, right?
Yep.
And then there are all these items. There's this thing, there's that thing. So what the fuck am I going to do with that? Well, I'll show you in a second. So these guys are chasing after me, and I'm like, you know what? Fuck shooting. I'm just going to turn into a mech.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right.
And Mike has a grappling hook, and I can do that. Which I wasn't very successful, but that's okay.
But I get the point. You can toss sword. Yeah. Dude, this is sweet.
Yeah. So this game gets way cooler. It's actually this chapter that he introduces.
Oh!
He introduces that. So you've got, like, your explosive barrels, right? You got your explosive barrels. Let me see if I could get this thing. Nope, I don't want that, but I can go ahead and chuck that away. This thing actually kills enemy shields.
Okay.
Yep, so that guy was affected for a second. So there are, like, some environmental hazards, like you see that jet of air right there. It's sort of, it's almost like an air pipe, that it can actually push enemies away. So say if I were to go through, like, a tight corner, and there was a pipe located there, I can just tap it, right?
Okay.
So that it could push the enemy out of that area, right?
Okay,
so
cool.
Let me just finish these guys off. I've actually grown very fond of the mech. That's kind of like my... That's kind of like my wheelhouse.
Yeah.
And I've done things... I've kept going back after I die, like, a million times. And I've kept practicing with the mech. And there are things in this game that, like, the combat system is very layered, right? So let me see if I can get this guy to shoot at me. So I could deflect bullets. There are enemies in this game that have swords. He has a shield. I can actually, I think I could actually parry with it. So I'm gonna just finish this off. Yeah, the explosions are goddamn gorgeous in this game. All right, let me finish this guy off. All right, so that's like sort of the basics of the combat.
Okay.
So I'm gonna, what am I doing? I'm retrieving a data cube, which I actually saw up top here. Okay, so I'm gonna be taking it somewhere. So this is the map.
Okay.
It's sometimes they may have like, you know, one to two parts to it. They may like, this is like an abandoned space station. There are times that you can actually be in an asteroid, and in an asteroid, which I'm not sure if we're going to actually catch footage on that, but it has different environmental hazards, which are really neat. So let me see if I could take this to where I need to be. There's like sort of like a hexagonal fog of war. And it's the incentive is to explore like every nook and cranny, because there are like a limited amount of chests that may have like certain blueprints that gives your ship different upgrades. I actually did get an auto upgrade that I forgot to explain a little bit earlier. So this is kind of an example of something that I can use, right? So say I could, you know, hit that, grab an enemy, throw and them into it. Like toss them into the fire. Right. Here's a ship ability right here. All right. So that is take no damage from fire and lava. So that happens in more like the asteroid field levels, which are really useful.
Okay.
Because I can fly close to the lava pits and take an enemy and just toss him in there.
Okay. Nice.
And I could even drag him in there with me, you know, because I don't take any damage. Right.
Cool.
Here's another nuance about like the combat that I've actually been doing. So I could throw him into that. You see he's a bit dizzy.
Yeah.
So I can take advantage of that and just keep tossing him into the wall.
Oops. Okay.
Okay. And just run up and keep hitting him into the wall. I'm not really having much success with it right now, but that's okay. So let's see. So yeah, that these things can actually kill you as well, or not kill, but kill your shield. So I have to be very, very careful.
Okay.
So it seems
almost like everything serves a purpose.
Yeah, and that's like the really, really cool thing about this game is that, like, it has almost like this this environmental design, like similar to a game like Far Cry.
Right.
The developer actually kind of referred it to the same thing too. Where you can pit enemies against each other, which, you know, as I said earlier, you would have like some success because sometimes they just ignore each other and go straight for you.
Right.
You can use the environments to your advantage. The asteroid stuff, man, I'm not sure if we'd be able to do that, but if we do, that'd be awesome because the asteroids have like some interesting stuff. All right, let me get rid of, oh, so I could do something like that. Just toss them over. Alright, yeah, unfortunately I killed him, so. This guy. So he's freaking out. Oops. Yeah, I think I accidentally hit like an explosive barrel. Alright, got rid of that guy. Okay. So, yeah, that's like the really cool stuff about this game.
Okay.
I prefer to fight in areas that have walls or like areas that I can sort of juke around because my combat style is I can hide in a corner and just catch somebody by surprise
right.
That way.
Okay.
Because this game does have like sort of a, again, you know, akin to Far Cry, where enemies patrol their areas with cones of vision, and I can avoid that. So. I don't know what are these guys doing. Okay. So maybe.
Gosh, there's so much going on.
yeah, it's ridiculous. There's one cool ability called like Parting Gift, which has become like my favorite. And basically what it does is it. Let me see if I can just highlight a bunch of guys and missiles. So Parting Gift is like one of my favorite abilities that you can get because as I grab somebody, if I can come within reach, and toss them, I don't have it, it attaches a bomb to them.
Okay.
And I have to be very, very careful though because there are times that I totally forgot that I had the Parting Gift perk equipped and I would grab them. Toss them,
then go get them, and then
yeah, and then it would just blow up in my face. Yeah, so I have to be very careful with that kind of stuff. All right, let me just finish this last guy off. So I did pretty decent in just that quick playthrough.
Mm-hmm.
I you know only received damage in my shields, I didn't take any permanent damage, but that is something that that does happen that gets you into a lot of trouble. So we may actually be able to do like an asteroid level. So once you get good at the game, you know, levels can be completed within like 10 minutes.
Right.
But in the much harder difficulties, it takes a lot longer. Like I'm talking like maybe a half an hour.
Okay.
If you're being very, very cautious and meticulous as you go. All right, so back to the ship. All right, so remember those upgrades that I was talking about?
Yeah.
So let's jump back to the store and see what's going on. Okay, cool. So here, you know, destroy Imperial machinery, blah, 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 another random mission. Hey, what happened to those upgrades? They're gone.
So do they change with each mission?
Yeah, which is a huge, I mean, that is my biggest beef with this game.
Okay.
After each level, the inventory in the store changes. So say if, you know, like as I started before, I had no salvage, no crash coins. You can't really trade in your crash coins. They do it for you.
Okay.
So it's not as if that's an option. But each and every mission, they rotate. So say if there's like an upgrade that looks really cool and you're just like, wow, like your initial thought would be, wow, I want to save up for that particular one. It's just like, you better save up for it, because you can actually access the store inside the levels themselves.
Okay.
Like, you can actually hear, like, one of the tips is, if you hear a reggae music, crashes this guy down here who runs the vendor. you know, as you kind of fly around and, you know, collect salvage, you can actually visit his store once you find him and purchase it there. If you don't save up enough money to buy an upgrade by the time you are done with the level,
mm-hmm.
those upgrades that you might have been looking forward to are gone.
Okay.
And it'll just re-rotate. And I don't like that.
So is it random, or is it like specific to the upcoming mission?
It's randomized.
Okay.
Yeah. And
I can see how that would kind of be irritating then.
Yeah, it's very, very frustrating, and it almost seems unnecessary because, I mean, yeah, I managed to make quick work in that mission, but that's because I've been playing this game for like probably like 15 hours and like really getting, you know, skillful in how. But once you're approaching these levels for the first time and you're just like, you know, like, oh, this particular item would really be useful in this situation, you know, it really sort of kills that progression, mentality. And like, another problem is you will collect blueprints, right? So a lot of these blueprints, like these two, for example, Sword Stunner and Nuts and Bolts, like these are blueprints that I unlocked from, you know, exploring the environment, finding blue chests and getting the blueprints from them. And it even takes time before there's a chance that you may not see that blueprint that you've unlocked for a couple of missions.
Because it's not being randomly inserted into the
exactly
upgrades.
Because they're randomized. So because of that, like, it is overly reliant on player skill, which is fine. But for me, I think like a nice happy medium would have been, okay, each season is randomized, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, throughout the five missions that you're going to be playing, you're going to have this inventory.
Right.
Right. So that you can at least save up for what you want to get. So, that is a huge bummer. I have 398. That's not a whole hell of a lot.
Yeah, I was going to say, it looks like you can only buy like one or two things there.
Yeah. And again, you know, like if I wanted any of these, you know, I don't have enough money for them right now. And if I don't get them within like the next mission, then that's it. You know?
Okay.
So I mean, in that case, you know, I mean, like the best strategy, in my opinion, is to say, all right, screw it. You know, I'll just, you know, keep saving money. So in case an upgrade turns up that I would want to get,
right,
I'll just buy that off the bat. So I'm not even going to bother buying anything.
Okay.
Which is a huge bummer. So let's hope that this next one is a asteroid, and then after that, that'll be the video.
So, in terms of, like you said, that only the final mission of each season is part of the story.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find the story interesting? Like, is this a game that you would play for the story or for the gameplay?
It's strictly gameplay.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, with it like roguelike type games aren't really fitted well for story.
Okay.
Because, you know, it's so centered on randomization, it's so centered on this is another goddammit. It's another you know what? I'll just quit.
I was just gonna say,
and this is this cool shit right
this
here.
It's funny, actually. Yeah. I like this.
It's very much like a VCR, which is really rad. I mean, the story is just kind of there. I mean, the banter between Beam and ATAC is, you know, kind of cute. You know, they have like these little quips with one another.
Yeah.
But I mean, you're not playing for this game for the story in any way. So. Yeah, all right. Okay, so this is like a whole bunch of new stuff. So, yeah. So he's saying that, you know, hey, kid, I see you got one of my crash coins, so let me trade it into salvage. So he took my one crash coin, and he just gave me 250 salvage.
Oh, that's a fair bit, considering it took you a whole level to get 350.
Yeah.
So one coin's 250. That's, you know... I can see why you'd want to save them up and trade them in.
And there's like some interesting things that could happen that will make you have to augment your approach to this game. So, for example, say if you go into a season, right, you get really, really far and you manage to get like 10 crash coins, which I think will bank you like, you know, 2,500 salvage.
Right.
So you jump back in, you trade in all of your crash coins, you get the 2,500. And then you jump right in, and then you get into like a shit show, and you die immediately, right? Mm-hmm. You lose all that salvage.
You got
no crash coins, so you basically just restarted everything,
that
right?
Sucks.
Yeah, and that's something that has happened to me a few times. So what I've had to do is I'm like, you know what? Fuck it. Like, this season is so hard that I'm not gonna go in, you know, empty-handed. So what I would do is I revert back to season one, which is easy. Especially, I mean, it's easy even if you go in comparison to the rest of the game, but it becomes even easier like once you manage to make it up to season four, like mm-hmm. you've gotten so good by that point. I mean, this is a game that is like your progression is merited by your skill. Right. I mean, okay. You don't get to season four by luck. You get there because you got fucking good at the game.
Right. Okay.
So, you know, I would jump back to season one, kind of just blow through that, get 10 crash coins. And then I would jump back to season four with 10 crash coins, trade that stuff in, get 2,500 salvage, and then I'm in a really good spot where I can buy almost any upgrades, actually any upgrade that comes across my path, as long as I save it up.
Right, okay.
Cool. So with this, I mean, again, you know, I'm not really in a position to buy much of anything. Like this, for example, Static Core, mm-hmm. there's no way in hell I'm going to get to buy this.
Right.
With 2,500. I'm not going to be able to get, you know, an extra 750 in the next mission to be able to purchase this, right. So I
and
can
then
just
it'll
say,
be gone by
yeah exactly second. By the time I okay. come back to the shop, it's going to be gone.
Okay,
so let's hope that this is the asteroid one, because the asteroid has some really interesting environmental hazards and tools that you can use. So I mean, this game is super, super strategic. Like, games like this is right in my wheelhouse in terms of I'm like a more action game kind of guy.
Okay.
I'm not really good at, you know, like, you know, methodical strategy or anything like that. Like, I like, you know, Twitch games. And this Twitchy game with, let me see, hey, Beam, I can actually tell. Satellites. Yes, all right, so we got some asteroids, which is good.
Sweet, let's see a few minutes of this. I want to...
Yeah.
Yes. Been talking the asteroid up, so I'm excited. You've been talking the asteroid up, so I want to see this.
Yeah. So, and, you know, there's, like, some... There's these that you can use to your advantage. You can do things like you could use them as shields. These are harder asteroids.
So they, like, don't blow up as easily.
They don't break as easily.
As the ones from that first level that you showed.
Yeah, like if I get into like a clusterfuck of enemies, I can sort of like, you know, guard myself with this. I can throw it at them. So, all right. Let's see. All right, so we got an ability right here, which is... 2 missiles per lock, which is good because it increases the power of my missiles.
Nice.
So I'm gonna sneak up on this guy. Alright, so there, I knocked him into that. This is a strategy that I've been using. Oh, if I can actually get to him, and he's shooting the shit out of me. Yeah, is I would just continuously knock them into a wall, make them dizzy, and then just keep doing that over and over and over again until they die. And this actually works with some of the larger enemies like that guy.
Okay.
Those guys are rhinos. They're like really scary motherfuckers. Like, I'm just gonna get in contact with him so you could like catch his dialogue, because they're really intense guys. Yeah, he's like a really scary guy, but like I keep doing that.
Right.
Okay, so yeah. I knocked him away from a wall. But he's already receiving damage. Like if you see his ship is kind of on fire.
Yeah.
What I usually do is if I'm in danger, I usually switch to his ship, because I mean you can use the shield, but let me see if I can get his attention and have him shoot at me. So the shield is receiving damage and eventually it'll disappear. Oh. So I like using the ship because I can actually, you know, juke over bullets and things like that.
Right. Okay, cool.
All right. So let me see if I can get close to this guy again. I feel no pain. Yeah. I mean, like, some people might look at this as cheesing, but man, fuck it. Like, this game is hard.
Whatever works, right?
Whatever works. Yeah, seriously. Alright, oh. These guys are kind of dangerous. Alright, so I'm gonna actually use my missiles against them. Yeah. Haven't seen some of, like, the interesting elements of, like, the... Oh, let me see. Throw him into a wall. Yeah, and like even doing things, not only does it make him dizzy, but it also does damage. You can see like some of the numbers popping off. Quick work of this guy. There we go. Done. All right.
Is this your objective, this thing, or what are you doing in this?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just...
Oh, you're, you know, destroying the satellites. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like, the objectives are very, you know, sort of cut and dry.
Right.
They're not anything, you know, they're not anything complex in any way, shape, or form. It's really the encounters and how you approach them that's where the complexity comes in, which is good enough. Okay. So
sounds like you're enjoying your playthrough of this game.
Yeah. Yeah, I do enjoy this game a lot. Like, when I discovered, when I found out about how the store itself, how the store randomizes inventory, I was really, really bummed out and upset about that. Mm-hmm. Almost to the point, like, I was thinking about, because, you know, I mean, as I'm reviewing the game, I had, like, a particular score in mind, and when I saw that, I dropped it tremendously in my head. Like, I was like, man, I'm only going to give this game this score instead of that score, because I really don't like that. But you know, as I played the game more, I, you know, got better at it. And I'm like, you know, I mean, I like it, but I still cannot forgive, because I think that design choice is unnecessary.
Right. I see.
You know, it's very unnecessary. I mean, like, it does have a certain element of gratitude or satisfaction where am I going? Okay. Where if you get like a really sweet upgrade and you manage to have enough salvage for it, like that is super satisfying. Mm-hmm. But that's by luck, you know. It's not necessarily like, okay,
nothing like, to do with eat. Patience or any, like, it's just exactly. Oh, hey, I have the thing, so I'll get it. Yeah.
Oh, so
here's... So you said you changed your score.
Uh huh.
So out of 100, do you have a power up gaming score in mind for Galak-Z?
I will reserve that once the review goes live.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's, so I mean, we'll see that. So these things.
So if viewers want to see your final score of Galak-Z, they have to check out your written review.
Yeah, check out my review. Okay. Yeah. So again, I should have it up by hopefully this week. So yeah, that, you know, they're kind of fucking around. So yeah, that this bubble thing right here, they actually slow down the movements. So if I'm not careful and accidentally, like, you know, run into a wall, they sort of accumulate on my ship and they slow my movement.
They're like little mini Goombas in Super Mario.
Yeah. These things are really rad. They're very similar to, like, those... I missed. They're very similar to, like, those electrical... those, like, loose electrical wires that were in the...
Okay.
Where they kill shields.
Okay.
Alright, there's a lot going on here. I'm gonna have to... Whoa. I don't know what happened there. Yeah, better get out of here. Cause I'm in trouble. Oh! Yep. Oh. You gotta watch out for stuff like that. Yeah. Like, the asteroids are a bit more dangerous.
Yeah, I can see. For both, like,
it's not... Yeah,
a lot more environmental stuff going on, too. Lots of environmental...
Yeah, there's tons of environmental stuff here. These are interesting, like the bubbles. So, say if I'm in a tight space and I shoot them, I don't know if you could see it, the bubbles actually reflect the, my bullets. Let me actually try it this way. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it's useful for like tight spaces so that the bulls can ricochet.
Right, okay.
And hopefully catch them instead of shooting it in a straight line. So. Well
played. Money in the bank. So, fans of roguelike games will appreciate this. Maybe modern Asteroids fans.
Yeah, could get into this. I would safely say so. I would say you know, beware of the shops.
Right.
You know, just know that this is a game that is all about your skill, and the upgrades that you get for your ship are almost secondary. There we go. Done.
All so right. First is your skill. Second is your upgrades.
Yeah, I mean the upgrades.
This game's about getting better at the game.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. I mean, this isn't a loadout game,
right?
This isn't a game where you can jump in and you get. And I had that in mind. Yeah, there he is, right? So this is the shop guy. I got 769. I mean, I can't really do much of anything, still. So as I said, I mean, like this upgrade that I want to get. I mean, there's no way I'm gonna be able to afford it.
Right. Okay. I mean,
with my experience here. What am I doing? Okay, but yeah, like as I said, this isn't a loadout game. This isn't a game where I can. You know, go in with like, oh, like this is like the sickest loadout, you know, that you can use.
Right.
There are some ideal ones that if I get lucky enough to get, I will definitely use like parting gift, as I said.
Yeah.
Where I can grab an enemy, you know, throw him away from me, and then there's a bomb attached to him. That's really cool. There's another ability that doubles the damage of my charge sword, which that is already a really powerful attack. And since I'm so good with the mech.
Right.
You know, like whenever I actually run into that, that's a loadout that I would like to have, but it's not a loadout that I'm guaranteed to have because again,
right, of course.
You know, it just all depends on what the store gives me. So.
Okay, so final score is yet to be determined, but if you're a fan of these types of games, or if you're just good at games in general, then this Galak-Z is probably
if you're a gamer that really enjoys I'm about to finish this stage. Okay. If you're a gamer that enjoys like getting better, I mean that is the real progression. Like the progression isn't necessarily unlocking new items, because I mean that does happen, but you know, who's to say if you'll actually have access to those items and when. But the real progression in this game is all about your skill.
Okay.
And you know, once you sort of like, okay, like let me see how I can, you know, maybe walk up on somebody with an asteroid, because there are ways in which you can sneak up on enemies with like a piece of debris and they won't be able to tell it's you because you have the debris in front of you, right? Taking advantage of little things like that, taking advantage of, oh, I have no missiles left. All right. Crap. I might die.
Oh.
Well, maybe not.
So, an enjoyable game. Just some unnecessary gimmicks.
Take some
of the fun away from you.
Yeah, there's like unnecessary, you know, difficulty to this game.
Right.
Unnecessary design choices to make this game harder than it really needs to
be. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so... Let me just get rid of this guy and then fuck off, please.
He's resilient.
Yeah, the AI in this game is like really, really they're really sophisticated.
Okay.
So yeah. That's
Galak-Z by who was 17-bit?
Yeah, it's out on the PlayStation Store. It's four episodes long, the fifth or four episodes, four seasons long. The fifth one should be coming out sometime between, I believe, like September, October, when it's available on Steam.
Cool.
But it's now up on PlayStation. Yep.
All right.
All right.
Sounds good. So, yeah, if this game looked fun to you, make sure to check it out. Check out 17-bit and their games.
Yep, and check out my review hopefully later this week.
Yes, that will be hopefully in the description. No, it will be in the description. I can say that for certain. Not a hopefully thing. It will be there. So, all right, take it easy.
Yep, all right. Thanks, guys.